Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back to our afternoon session. First of all, I would like to acknowledge the Resource Support Unit here in WIT for not just organising this event, but organising past events. And I think it could safely be said that if new idea or innovation is based on new ideas, then today is a perfect opportunity for us to be innovative. And I think the value of this can't be underestimated. And it's something I'm going to point to in a few moments in terms of some of the new research directions that are taking place in WIT as well. My name is Peter McLaughlin. I'm the head of School of Science and Computing here in WIT. And it's a particular honour for me to announce and to introduce some of the activity that's going on in the school. As I said, I would really like to extend my thanks to the Research Support Unit for organising the day and for the food and all of the literature and making this such a professional day. And I think it's one of the hallmarks of the way in which the day has progressed over the years is the standard of the presentations and how they've improved and the posters as well over the years. It'd be very remiss of me, I think, before I start, not to acknowledge one person here, and that is Professor Willie Donnelly, who has been at the forefront of development of research in the Institute here since he's came. And I would like to obviously congratulating on his elevation to President of the Institute. But if you, I suppose, humour me, and if you would just join with me in acknowledging Willie's contribution to research over the years. The head is swelling, yeah. I had to do it before you came in the room, Willie, in case you didn't get out. I'd like to thank all the contributors to today for their excellent presentations. And as I said already, it's a fantastic opportunity to foster innovative ideas through exposure to ideas from across the different academic disciplines as well. We're very, very fortunate in the School of Science in that we have seen particular growth in a large number of research domains over the years. And we now have research in as diverse areas as from health science to land sciences, telecommunications, material science, pharmaceutical science, and molecular biotechnology, just to mention but a few. In terms of the scale and how things have grown currently, we have, I was just checking before I came down, about 36 registered PhD students in the school and 13 master's students. So that gives you an idea of the scale of the operations that we've reached. And in today's research day, we've got to, I think it's 27 different individual contributions to the day here, to the research day. I'm not going to say much, but I really wanted to just push one or two things which are the hallmark of research now in the School of Science and Computing. One that you will see, and you'll see it from the speakers in a few moments, is the multidisciplinarity of the research and how that has changed over the years. Also, it's external engagement. In some of the speakers today, we have partners in the UK, we have partners in Finland, we have partners in as far away as Cork even, I think. And those partnerships, as I said, are the hallmark of what we do. Today's event has been critical in building that multidisciplinarity. A number of years ago, PhDs and the hallmarks of those would have been people within the department, say, for example, in the individual departments carrying out research. Now you have research carried out across multiple schools in the college and across different disciplines, obviously, as well. I'm particularly delighted as well this year, and you will see outside in some of the poster presentations in particular, that there's a lot of research output's been presented today by new researchers into the Institute as well, which I'm particularly delighted with. Indeed, 6 of the 15 PhD scholarships this year in WIT went to the School of Science and Computing and to new researchers as well, so I'm particularly delighted with that. As I said, that's me. I'm going to shut up for the moment. I'm delighted to be able to chair this session and to share some of the research ideas that are emanating, as I said, from the school. The first of our presenters today is from the Macular Pigment Research, or sorry, it's Ursula, I think, is going to give the presentation first, isn't it? No, it's not. Sorry, lads. It's Kwaijo. Kwaijo from the Macular Pigment Research Group is going to give a presentation to his first, and his research is entitled Macular Pigment and Visual Function in Early Age-Related Macular Degeneration, CREST, a Randomised Clinical Trial. So, Kwaijo, I'm delighted to have you here. Thank you.
I'll just move straight in. So, Macular pigment is a yellow pigment which is located at the back of the eye in an area known as the macula. And this pigment is composed of three carotenoids, lutein, zeaxanthin, and mesozeaxanthin. And this pigment acts as a blue light filter and has antioxidant and anti-inflammatory properties. So you can see here that the macula with macular pigment, there is a filtration there. It acts as a protective shield, limiting damage caused by free radicals. And then the macula without macular pigment, you see that all these blue lights are not screened, and therefore there is more damage to the retina in the macular area. And all these properties of macular pigment contribute to the normal function of the macula. So macular degeneration is the leading cause of blindness in the developed world. And AMD affects 1 in 14 people aged 50 years and over in the Republic of Ireland. And in AMD, it affects the macular area, which is this part, which is shown in this retinal photograph. And with time and with age, that area degenerates. And there is pigmentary changes, small yellow spots known as drusen appear. And then they could go on to the more advanced stage where the whole place is covered. And then this is an example of the advanced stage known as geographic atrophy. This disease affects the central part of the retina, which is the macula, and therefore activities that require this part are affected. The macula is the area which we use for central vision, high definition vision, and therefore activities such as recognizing faces, reading, driving are affected in this condition. This study was designed to investigate the relationship between macular pigment, which is in this part of the retina, and how best we see that visual function in subjects with early AMD. And this was conducted as part of the Central Retina Enrichment Supplementation Trial, which is a randomized clinical trial, and that clinical trial randomized people to two intervention groups, which is shown in this table. And subjects have their baseline 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, and 24 months study visits. And eligibility criteria, or criteria for enrollment in this trial, is shown here, which includes having early AMD in at least one eye, and then having driving vision at least, that's greater than or equal to 6/12. A range of visual function measures, that's a range of measures designed to assess how best people see, was used. And this includes the typical black letters on white background, which you normally have when you visit your optician, which is known as the best corrected visual acuity. And then we go on to assess when these letters fade away, are people able to still see them? And that's known as letter contrast sensitivity. We assess their reading acuity and speed. Reading acuity is just the depth to which they can read at 40 centimeters using the RATNA chart. And then the speed at which they can read on average is also assessed. We go on to assess subjectively, how do these people report their visionness? So do they say that their vision is better or worse? That's also assessed using the National Institute NEI questionnaire. We assess the level, the impact of a light stress on the eye using the photo stress recovery test. And then we go on to simulate nighttime, daytime, nighttime with glare, and daytime with glare conditions using the functional vision analyzer. And subjects enrolled in this trial are required to see these targets. As you can see, these are gratings, and then they decrease in contrast in those four simulated conditions. And we assess the amount of scatter within the eyes using the ocular sequin meter. And we measure finally the macular pigment levels using the macular densitometer, which helps us to assess that at four different eccentricities, that's 0.25, 0.5, 1 degree, and 1.75 degrees. So this shows the demographic profile of subjects enrolled in this study. Only baseline data is analyzed as part of this study, and therefore this represents only a cross-sectional relationship between macular pigment and visual function in these subjects. And you can see that the mean age was 64.77, and then there were more females than males, and then they were less likely to be current smokers. The relationship between macular pigment and visual function was assessed using a bivariate was first assessed by assessing bivariate relationships using Pearson correlation coefficient that we went on to adjust for age and sex in a general linear model. And this shows the results of that relationship. And only photo stress recovery, light scatter, and that's nighttime with glare disability weren't associated with macular pigment increases. But particularly, subjects in this study reported that the higher their macular pigment, the better their vision, that's the sharper their vision. And then also, they reported that they had better general health when they had higher macular pigment, as well as the less likelihood for them to depend on others because of their vision. So in conclusion, this study shows that macular pigment relates to visual function, and the randomized clinical trial is also going to add to that evidence. And the food we eat provides these carotenoids, which are dietary pigments, and therefore a healthy diet rich in fruits and vegetables is essential for the optimization of health and the improvement of vision. I'd like to thank the European Research Council for supporting this project and my supervisors, Professor John Nolan, Professor Stephen Beatty, and Dr. Tundai Petro in Moorfields Eye Hospital. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Kwan Jo. That was very interesting. I'd like to open to questions, please. Brendan, yeah.
Thank you, Kaija. I'm just curious as to why people with diabetes were excluded from the study.
Yeah. So people with diabetes normally show, when there is increase in sugar in the blood, it also affects the lens within the eye. I'll just go on to the first. So this is the structure of the eyes. And when there is increase in sugar, or that's diabetes, normally it affects so many structures. But particularly, the reason why people with diabetes were excluded is because when there is increase in sugar, it affects the lens within the eye. It gets more, the index within the lens gets stronger, and therefore it affects how best they see. So looking at the primary outcome of this study is actually visual function. So if we're going to assess how best people see, we don't want any other external factors which we can control to affect how best they see. And that's why those subjects were excluded. Thank you.
I just wanted to ask you, what is the main source of blue light? Would it be the sun, or is there a lot of blue light inside?
Thank you for your question. So blue light normally is found in a range of sources, like internally in this room, these fluorescent tubes all emit blue light to some degree. And also you can see that the skies outside normally on a lovely sunny day 2 weeks ago, can see that it's blue. If the Irish weather doesn't set in. So the blue light is a short wavelength light, and it's more scattered because there are more particles in the air which scatter those blue lights. So we're exposed to blue light in a range of varying conditions. The only thing is that there might not be so much that you would actually see that they are.
If you look at a lot of kids now, you know, what do parents give kids to keep them quiet for an hour? It's this real high blue light intensity, and I predict it'll be very, very damaging in the future to the visual function. So it's a good question, but that's why filters and nutrition as filters is going to be a key player in protecting against these new technologies.
I think Caroline.
So what the optician prescribes, those anti-glare lenses will be looking at trying to help you to adapt in various levels of glare, but they are not necessarily directed to blue light. And within the eyes, the reason why the macular pigment or nutrition, it's very important, is because it's in the macular area, we don't have any short wavelength blue light sensitive cones. And so the macular area naturally can't handle blue light. But blue light is needed, for instance, for night vision and for other vision. So it's very important that the levels of dietary pigment is increased either by through diet or supplements in order to protect that area, and that could also improve vision. But with the sunglasses, all that it does is to protect you from ultraviolet light. So it could be, depending on the grade of sunglasses you have, either it's protecting you against UVA, UVC, or UVB. So it has different grades. But it's very important that blue light is screened at the macular area because of the way the anatomy of the eyes is. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we better leave it at that. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Our next speaker is Michael Barros, who is going to give us a presentation entitled Smart Disease Detection with Molecular Communication. And Michael is carrying out his research in the TSSG.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As Peter said, thank you, Peter, for the introduction. I will talk about smart disease detection using molecular communications. Basically, here we are mixing a little bit of telecommunications, biology, and nanotechnology, and creating some kind of application for medicine. I'm supervised by Dr. Sastara Balasubramanian. He's in Finland at the moment, and Dr. Brendan Jennings. Okay. What is molecular communications? When you talk on the phone, we use electromagnetic waves to reach people in other distances around the road. But this is one type of communication. We now came up with another type, which is molecular communications. Now we encode information into molecules. We can code these molecules, for example, DNA, or we can create some kind of disease, some kind of concentrations and encode data, bits, zeros and ones, in the levels of concentrations. We have two types of transmission. We have active transport and diffusion. Here, I use bacteria to create a nanonetwork. And we program the bacteria, encode information to their DNA, and they will drag the information from one place to another. We also work with diffusion, and I'll explain it later, with using calcium signaling. The main advantage of this approach is to use this natural process to perform communication. So we don't have to engineer anything, just to have to learn from nature and control it. I work with calcium signaling. It's a diffusion process. Calcium signaling is found inside us, in our tissues, and it's a short range signaling process. It regulates cell growth, cell proliferation, cell death. It works very simple way. It is governed by certain chemical reactions, and due to stimulation, it upfines the signal inside the cell and then it propagates throughout the tissue. This propagation is mediated to gap junctions, which are those yellow things here. And once they are opened, the molecules are allowed to flow from one cell to another, perform cell-to-cell communication. And why we do this? We vision applications, again, in medicine. One of the main applications is tissue engineering, where we are looking to control the growth of the cellular tissues. And one way is using calcium signaling. Researchers came up with this bioprinting here, which is a 3D printer responsible to regenerate organs that are even cut. So now Professor Langer is looking ahead into inserting nanorobots or nanosensors inside their smart organs or the organs and make them regenerate themselves. My research is mainly focused on mathematical models. And we created this mathematical framework that models 3D tissues and the reactions inside each cell. Also, we have developed source nanomachines and destination nanomachines, which are basically stimulation points and measuring points where we stimulate the tissue, and at further distance, we collect that information. And we are able to study the propagation of it. Also, we want to look at compression. And why is that? Because different tissues affect the shape of the cells and the propagation, the flow of calcium. So in this way, we can differentiate. If we can measure somehow the propagation of it, the disturbance of the tissue, we can detect disease. And that's what we did with the molecular nanonetwork inference process. Basically, we have here, for example, in these two scenarios, we have different stimulation points and a central point where we stimulate the tissue in different parts of the, we stimulate the tissue in different parts, and then we get the data in a central point. We collect the data, perform some statistical analysis, then we create a sample, then we train our nanomachines to detect tissue deformation. They would be able to identify the tissue is deformed or not, what type of deformation, the amount of deformation, how much calcium is coming, and the distance between the stimulation point to the measurement point. And studying all this, creating data, the system itself can detect if the tissue is healthy or not. We have done preliminary results. This is ongoing research. This is my last research topic in my PhD. And we got results from 80 to 85% of accuracy. And also this research was already published. Now we want to expand this. We have three types of tissues that we want to look at. We have non-excitable cells, which we study the epithelial cells. The excitable cells, which are its smooth muscle cells, and astrocytes. And in this way, it's relevant to talk about this mixture of telecommunications, biology, and nanotechnology, and develop this kind of new approaches to enhance and even change a little bit what we know about medicine. And that's it. Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much indeed, Michael. Has anybody got any questions for Michael? John?
Yeah, could you maybe comment on, you mentioned gap junction.
Yeah.
I'm particularly interested in gap junction in the brain and with Alzheimer's disease. I think it's one of the factors that the gap junction breaks down.
True.
People can hear me. And we're interested in that from a nutrition point of view in enhancing the gap junction between the neurons. And I just wonder, have you a comment on gap junction particularly?
The thing is the gap junctions, they open and close, do a certain distribution. And if they fail to open and close, of course, the disease will be affected on that. Alzheimer had a particular standard. I haven't studied Alzheimer yet, but we also are looking to that. In Alzheimer, there is another interesting feature is that it communicates astrocytes and neurons. So it's kind of more heterogeneous scenario. And we want to look at Alzheimer in particular as well, but not at the moment. We just created some kind of more general framework.
I think we should look at it in Horizon 2020 as a collaborative project. I think it makes sense.
That'll be great.
Okay, has anybody got any more questions? I have one, Michael, in terms of the model that you generated.
Sure.
Can the model be utilized then to study, say, different stress parameters using calcium as the model as a case study? Say, for example,
sure.
Disruption to the skin, say, for example. Could you use your model then to look at the regeneration of the skin based on that type of disruption?
No, not yet. We're not looking at the regeneration yet.
Okay.
Regeneration is just a further development.
Okay. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you.
Okay, if nobody has any more questions, I'd like to thank Michael again for his presentation.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Ursula McCormack, and Ursula is supervised by Dr. Gillian Gardner and Dr. Pather Lawler. Gillian Gardner is based here in WIT in the Eco Innovation Research Centre, and Pather Lawler is based down in the Chagas Research Centre down in Moor Park in Cork. And her presentation today is investigating the potential of the intestinal microbiota to impact feed efficiency in pigs. Thanks, Ursula.
Thanks, Peter. Hello. I'm a PhD student based in the pig department in Chagas and Moor Park, and my PhD is part of the EcoSC project, so it involves 17 partners around Europe involved in improving feed efficiency in pig and poultry production systems. So just a bit of background then into my project. Feed is greater than 75% of the cost of producing a pig. Because this cost is so high, farmers and producers are constantly looking for ways to decrease this cost, so in order to improve profit at the end of the year. The intestinal microbiota then is a collection of microorganisms located along the gastrointestinal tract of humans and animals, and it has been linked with health, immunity and nutrient digestion. So with this link then in mind, there's a potential to possibly manipulate or alter the microbiota present through different intervention strategies. And then all of these three then will link, hopefully, to improve feed efficiency. So increase the amount of gain by reducing the amount of feed given. And this will then reduce the costs of production. The objective then of the first part of my PhD was to examine the fecal microbiota profiles of pigs with good versus poor feed conversion efficiency. Materials and methods then. We took 7 litters of piglets and we housed them individually. We recorded their growth performance every 2 weeks, so their weight gain and their feed intake. And then because there's always a variation between pigs for feed efficiency, we ranked them on the basis of residual feed intake, where residual feed intake is the difference between the observed feed intake and that predicted by growth, with a lower number indicating a better, more feed efficient animal. So we had 3 ranks, low, medium and high, and we had 10 pigs per rank. We took different samples from the pigs throughout their lifetime, and we analysed faecal samples from weaning, so when the pigs were weaned from their mother, day 42 and day 139 post-weaning. We took faecal samples because they're a good indication of what happens at gut level. So from these samples that we analysed then, we did 16S RNA gene sequencing using the Illumina MiSeq platform. This is the most up-to-date version of sequencing available, and it gives us an indication of what the bacterial groups are present at phylum, family, and genus level, and then we analyse the data statistically using SAS. Our results then, this table shows the relative abundance in percent of taxa for the statistically different phylum and family, or sorry, family and genus levels of pigs with different feed efficiencies. So just to recap, the pigs were ranked on residual feed intake, with low being the better feed efficient pigs and high being the poor feed efficient. So you can see here that we did find some differences at family level, and these then were reflected at genus level. So you can see that Streptococcus was 0.8% of the microbiota present in the good feed efficient pigs. And some species of Streptococcus are potentially pathogenic, so they're disease-causing. So this would then indicate that the better feed efficient pigs were healthier. Campylobacter then was the opposite. They were higher for the low feed efficient pigs. This is kind of difficult to explain because, again, Campylobacter is potentially disease causing. We did find some differences, a lower relative abundance for other genus as well. So moving on then, this is a principal component analysis, and it shows a clustering effect of how our data looked. So it's before the microbiota was categorised at phylum, family and genus level. In contrast to the last slide, we actually found no differences between feed efficiency rank for the microbiota, but there was a clear difference for day, so age of the animal, and litter of origin, so the sow effect. So the circles then, or the ovals, represent the day or the age of the animal, and each dot is a pig, and the colours then are the same colours are the same litters. So you can see here that at weaning, or when the pigs were weaned from the mother, that there's a distinct clustering effect of the age of the animal. And this then is seen at day 42 post-weaning and at day 139 post-weaning. And we did find that there was some microbiota clustering for these days, for the age of the animal. And this would then indicate a microbiota grouping according to litter origin, so the sow influence. So this is just a kind of an aside slide. It shows the differences of phylum level over time. So we didn't find a statistically significant difference of the bacterial phyla between the feed efficiency groups, but we did find a difference over time. So you can see on the y-axis the relative abundance in percent, and across the x-axis then is the different phyla. And the red is weaning, the blue is day 42 post-weaning, and the yellow is day 139 post-weaning. And you can see then that there's differences across the lifetime of the pig for the different phylum levels. So in conclusion then, we only found 2 out of the 98 bacterial families and 4 out of the 212 genera were different, statistically different for the different feed efficiency ranks. These numbers, although they're small, they could be important, and they could actually help us explain the differences for feed efficiency between pigs. We did see that there was a age effect for the fecal microbial profile, as well as the sow influence, so the litter origin did have an effect. So just before I go on, we did find some differences between feed efficiencies, so we know what microbiota is there, we just now need to know what it's doing. So we need to investigate the functionality of these intestinal microbiota. We also have more intestinal samples that we took at slaughter to analyse. We have 4 more batches of pigs from different countries to analyse, and all of this will then hopefully further the knowledge of the microbiota and its impact on feed efficiency. We have dietary intervention strategies commenced in Moorpark, and these are looking then to see if we can influence the microbiota through different dietary methods. And I'd just like to acknowledge then quickly the funding sources. So the ECOFC project is funded for the European Union 7 framework. My PhD is funded through the Chagas Squash Fellowship Programme. And I'd just like to say a huge thank you to everyone who helped out in the project. It's much appreciated. Thank you.
Ursula, thank you very much indeed for your presentation. Really enjoyed it. Has anybody got any questions for Ursula? Yes?
It seems, thanks for the presentation, it seems that the family of origin of the pig had quite a big influence, mm-hmm. kind of the breeding better than feeding kind of effect. Did we look at the microbiota of the sow? Of the
It's actually one of the things that we have left to analyse, but the pig is actually born with a sterile gut, so it's colonised at birth from the sow. So, it's hugely important.
Any other questions for Ursula? Ursula, can I ask you one on the feeding intervention strategies that you're using? What type of strategies are you utilising, and are any of those feed products using kind of natural products, say, for example?
We have a prebiotic trial ongoing, so we're using inulin to see if it can alter the microbial profile, so increase the beneficial and reduce the potentially pathogenic. We also have a fecal inoculum trial ongoing that we took fecal samples from the most feed efficient pigs of the last trial that we did, and we inoculated sows and piglets at different time points. So we're seeing if those kind of strategies will hopefully influence the microbiota.
Great, and thank you. Yeah. Thanks very much, Ursula. Okay, I'd just like to thank Ursula again for her presentation. Thank you. Our next presenter is John Power, and John works with the Molecular Ecology Research Group here as part of the Eco Innovation Research Centre. And John's work is carried out in conjunction with partners in Poland, and his presentation is called Non-Invasive Genetic Monitoring of Pine Marten and Stone Marten in and around the Neoperic Bat Hibernation Site in Poland. Thank you, John.
Okay, we'll go straight in. My project is involved in non-invasive genetic monitoring of pine marten and stone marten in Neoperic in Poland. It's a collaboration between WIT, the Vincent Wildlife Trust, and Rockcliffe University, and is funded by the Irish Research Council. So Neoperic Bat Hibernation Site, then, is situated roughly between Berlin and Poznan. It's now in western Poland, but was once part of Germany and was constructed during World War II in order to defend against an attack on Berlin from the east. It consists of about 15 kilometres of above-ground fortifications that are connected by about 35 kilometres of tunnels, which are about 50 metres below the ground. After the war, it was abandoned and taken over by bats. About 37,000 bats from 10 different species inhabit this system each year. It's now a Natura 2000 site with 4 different species on the Habitats II directive found down there during annual surveys. The tunnels itself then, to facilitate these surveys, the tunnels themselves were divided into 9 sections in order to help with the counting of these bats. The above ground area supports both pine marten and stone marten, and you can tell these two animals apart physically, but you require molecular techniques to tell their scats apart. Recent surveys have suggested that pine marten or stone marten may be entering the tunnels and preying on hibernating bats. Their scats have been found in the tunnels, as well as scratch marks on the walls close to where bats have been hibernating. And just by way of confirmation, this photograph here is what we now know is a stone marten scat containing a Daw Benton's bat skeleton. These two photographs here just give you some idea of the size of the tunnels inside and the use of headlamps to navigate. Above ground then, there's anti-tank defences that go along the lines of the tunnels, and these raised concrete defences provide an area where pine marten or stone marten may scat on to protect their territory or mark their territorial bases. The aims then were to conduct a molecular analysis that identifies species, sex and individuals from scats, and a molecular-based dietary study to detect bat species DNA in scats. So DNA extracted from these samples then is used to look at the distribution of boat marten species, determine if boat marten are entering the tunnels, if there's any difference in ranges above and below ground, or if boat marten are involved in the bat predation. If there is any bat predation on of any particular bat, in especially any of the more protected species, and any impact on these bat population as a result of marten predation. So the plan then was to use scat surveys to gather samples for molecular analysis. With DNA extracted from these non-invasively collected samples, then we used probe-based qPCR assays for species identification and sex determination, and I designed novel bat species-specific primers to identify bat DNA in scats, again using qPCR. And we used microsatellite analysis for individual animal identification. So the scat surveys themselves, there were six main scat surveys that surveyed the entirety of the tunnels over between 2012 and 2014. Cover the above ground area to correspond with these tunnels in the northwest forest here. Understandably and thankfully, this was not a one-man job, and here are some of the photographs of some of the volunteers that gave me a hand in this. So briefly then, the results of the species assay, you can see that roughly of the 1,800 samples that were collected, about two-thirds of them could be identified with either pine marten or stone marten DNA. Again, there was more stone marten in total and more stone marten found in the tunnels, or more stone marten scats found in the tunnels. And of the scats that gave non-marten DNA or no marten DNA, there were 74 of them turned out to be fox scats. I used triangles to mark the location of the scats, green for pine marten, brown for stone marten. And you can see the stone marten scat distribution is largely in the open areas, and we have the pine marten scat distribution is mostly in the forested areas. And this corresponds to previous literature. It's what we'd expect from these two martens. You can see a gap in the northwest forest where there was no scats found from either marten, but when we superimpose the fox data in blue, this gap is nicely filled. I inverted the triangles to denote the below ground distribution, and you can see that throughout the system there is marten to be found, with mostly stone marten in the south and only pine marten in the north. And if you have a look on the right, then it largely corresponds to the distribution of above ground scats. There's a couple of exceptions, of course. In yellow here, you can see the bat densities throughout the system, and I was expecting to find a correlation or a relationship between the bat densities and scat densities on our initial assumptions. But if you look at the scat densities, there doesn't appear to be a direct relationship or an obvious relationship between these two. And you can see that here and here, there's areas where there's high scat densities and there's very few bats present. So I had a look to see, was there any pattern to these scat densities? And starting with section 8, where we can see there's a lot of pine or stone marten scats, there's also four access points. And if we plot the four access points in relation to the number of scats collected in these areas, we can see that marten are depositing their scats close to these access points. This holds true again for section 7 and section 5, which also have a lot of stone marten scats. And if you keep in mind that this is 50 metres below the ground, it's in total darkness, this may be that the marten are using an olfactory or a chemical auto-communication to navigate in total darkness. And I liken this to an olfactory Hansel and Gretel approach, perhaps. In the northern section, there's mostly pine marten scats that are found. And if we just briefly look, in May, there was only one pine marten scat found in section 3, but there was 21 scats found, so these were only left between May and September. So this tells me marten are entering the tunnels when bats are not hibernating. And this may be to prey on bats in daily torpor. It may be to scavenge on dead bats. It could be thermoregulation, but it might also be predator avoidance, because of all the 74 scats found from foxes, they were all found above ground. So it may be just simply predator avoidance, most likely a combination of all these things. Again, for individual animal identification, I used the triangles, only this time it's blue for a boy, pink for a girl. And of the pine marten genotypes, we found 20 individuals, 11 females, 9 males, multiple recaptures across surveys and above and below ground. And if we plot these multiple recaptures, we can see there's a territorial loyalty exhibited that you'd expect from marten. With the stone marten genotypes, then again, there was 21 individuals, 10 females, 11 males. Above ground and below ground recaptures were found across surveys again, And once again, this territorial loyalty was exhibited. So I tested all the positive samples for bat DNA using my primers, and you can see that there was, from the top to the bottom here, there was multiple Martin species, multiple bat species found in Martin DNA across the system. If you plot this, if you just look at this, all you need to see here is that from the 20 pine Martin individuals and 21 stone Martin individuals that were identified, approximately half the scats samples tested from individual Martin contained bat DNA. And if you plot this by bat species, you can see that most of them were either Daubenton's bats, greater mouse-eared, or Natterer's bats. Now this looks like a lot, but if you plot that as percentage of the bats that are actually in the system throughout the year, they're quite low, with the exception of the 6% or two bats that were contained two scats that contained Bechstein's DNA. Now it must be noted that these two scats were actually turned out to be from the same stone Martin and were picked up in the same survey period, so it may actually be the same bat being detected. So conclusions then, both Martin species in the tunnels, the distribution and territoriality largely conserved, multiple divisions in the tunnel, both species are consuming bats, more abundant bat species more frequent in scats, and the impact at the moment appears to be low. And I'd like to thank these people very quickly. Apologies for the overrun, and thank you for your time. I welcome any questions.
John, thanks a million for the presentation. I really enjoyed it.
Sorry about it, Lee.
You're okay. Could I ask, is there any questions for John on his research? Richie?
Very interesting presentation. In terms of the pine marten that go into the tunnels, is there any breakdown on gender there, male or female, or one of them more likely to?
There is actually. Now, on the table that you saw briefly earlier on there, there isn't a breakdown in gender going down to the tunnels. It seems to be about 50-50, 55-45. But what there is the recaptures. The number of recaptures of females down there is a lot more than males for both stone marten and pine marten. And this, as like, there's sexual dimorphism exhibited in mustelids, and the smaller is the female, obviously. And they will, like, during times of scarcity, will go for smaller, more easily accessible prey. And especially, certainly if they're scavenging, but even if they're preying on the bats that are easily accessible to them, they're good climbers, and some of these bats roost very low during winter. That may be why they're actually going down there. And there is a direct relationship. There's a lot more females, not a lot more females entering the tunnels, but they're entering the tunnels a lot more frequently than the males.
Thank you very much.
Okay, any more questions for John?
Just wondering if it's having an effect on their other prey that they eat on. I mean, is this a very small part of their diet? Or
it would be a very small. They're very opportunistic feeders, and they have a wide dietary niche now. And they will eat anything from small mammals to seeds. They're frugivorous a lot of the time. They will eat pretty much anything. Stone marten have been known to get up into the middle of cars and eat the cables. They're considered pests in a lot of parts of Europe, and they will eat the cables inside in the cars. So it's only one part of the marten's diet. It's more. I was more worried about what specific species of bats they were actually eating.
So you don't know what favourite bat species?
No, that would certainly, if there was the Bechstein's bats. Now there's only 30 Bechstein's bats ever on average found down in the tunnels, and they happen to be one of the four species that are on the Habitats II directive, and they're red listed as population decreasing. Mm. Now the two, like I said, the two scats that were found did happen to be from the same stone marten. It is a very small sample size, two from 30. If we looked at it from the year before, it would have been zero, but it's a reference point. If every year these bats are going to be surveyed, and if over the next 5 years you see a gradual decline in any of these species, we now have a reference point where we can go look and go, well, in 2015 there was this amount being consumed, and now we have genotypes, we have the primers to detect the bats. It'll be a lot simpler to go to collect some scats and see, is there any marked increase or decrease in bat predation?
Thanks a million, John. If there's no more questions, I'd like to thank all of the speakers from this session for the very interesting presentation.
Thanks a million, Peter. Okay, so that actually concludes the oral presentations today. And I think if we have one final round of applause for all presenters here today, because I think they were excellent. I now like to invite the panel, Willie, Anne and Richie, to come with me, and we'll do some final deliberations and choose a winner here today. And our next session is actually the three-minute thesis competition, which will be chaired by Dr. Niamh Murphy, where I saw Niamh there a second ago. There you are. Can I remind all the presenters in the three-minute thesis competition that you can't advance your slides? You have three slides. When you come up, you hit next slide, and then there's a minute timing on all of the slides. You can use the pointer all right, but you can't actually move on to the next slide. It will do it automatically because this section really needs to be timed very well. So I'll introduce Dr. Niamh Murphy now to take you through this session. Thanks a million.
Hi, I'm delighted to be here because I'm just about to introduce the bravest and the most innovative people of the whole day. Willie Donnelly thinks he's got a big job, you know, being president. That's not a patch on what we were asking these guys to do. They've spent at least 3 years, and we're asking them in 3 minutes to summarise that. That's like asking someone to conceive and grow and give birth to a baby in 45 seconds. I was working it out. So, in advance, well done to everybody who's volunteered. We have 8 presenters. We have 3 judges. So our 3 judges are Brendan Jennings, Sheila Donegan, and Ray Griffin. And they are going to be sitting here listening very carefully. I'm just going to introduce the name of the person, and I'm going to let them tell you the title of their talk. And there's going to be 3 minutes, followed by 1 question from the panel. If a question isn't forthcoming from the panel, we can take 1 quick one probably from the floor. So this is pretty tight. It's 24 minutes in total of concentration. So without wasting any more time, I will just introduce the first speaker, and that is Niall Crosby from the School of Business, and Bill O'Gorman is Niall's supervisor.
Thank you. My research concerns the regional innovation paradox. Now, this paradox is really about perceived underinvestment in innovation in lagging or what we'd call poorer regions. Now, in particular, the proponents of this paradox would suggest that these are the kind of regions that especially need to invest in innovation in order to be able to foster growth and competitiveness. Yet, at the same time, there does appear to be evidence that this kind of region can continue to underinvest in innovation, despite the fact, in a lot of cases, that public monies and EU monies are being made available in these regions in order to foster innovation. So this can be down to a number of reasons. For example, the region maybe just finds it difficult to prioritise investment for innovation purposes. Secondly, the region, even if it has prioritised investment for innovation purposes, it finds it difficult to spend the money. And thirdly, in other cases where money has been spent, the region might find it difficult to generate the right kind of outputs in order to generate beneficial innovative performance. So the core of my research is really based around a hypothesis then that resolving this paradox is kind of based around improving the broader innovation capacity of these regions within the context of what's referred to as a regional innovation system. So that means, therefore, it's not really just about investing money in R&D or innovation directly per se, but there's also a variety of other factors that the region needs to work on in order to enhance its capacity in these areas, such as the existing capabilities of the firms in the region, the mix of skills that are available, the capacity of the region to absorb knowledge and learning for innovation purposes, the quality of the kind of collaboration networking that's ongoing between different actors in the region, and then also things like the policy and institutions and governance and so on. So where my research is heading is to look at a number of case studies of differing performing regions in terms of how they've got on and how these factors have impacted on this. In the final slide, you can see there's a clear distinction, say, on the left-hand side between regions that are predominantly green, which are regions that have absorbed EU monies well and performed well in innovation terms. And yet on the other side, you'll see a lot of red regions, which are more regions that have experienced low absorption of EU monies and also low performance in innovation terms. But in between as well, there's a few other regions which we may look at on a case study basis that provide a mix of this kind of performance. So really we're trying to, from this, get insights from a number of regions through case studies in order to develop some ideas about what's going on underneath this paradox. Thank you.
Very well done. Any questions from the panel?
Well, the literature on the paradox tends to focus on the policy, the institutions, the governance side of things as being the facilitator for the others. So if you were to look at that, the second slide in particular, you can obviously kind of think that, you know, well, R&D investment may be dependent on the mix of skills that you have already, that can generate investment. So, you know, there's a policy angle there in terms of how you get those skills. Likewise with the collaboration and networking, if you improve that, that can trigger the R&D investment, which ultimately might deliver the benefits. So in terms of where the case studies are probably likely to focus, it's probably around that kind of bottom left-hand corner of that slide, because that's where the kind of commentators on the paradox really focus on where things can be done at that kind of macro government or regional level.
Thanks very much.
Thanks.
Well done. Our second presenter is also from the School of Business, and that's Oksana Doherty.
Hello, everybody. My research is in the area of behavioral finance, and this is actually my first attempt to narrow it down to a 3-minute speech, so I jump right in. I just pressed the enter button, yeah? Okay, we all know how product endorsements work and why they're used. You get a celebrity person to use one of your products and somewhere publicly and preferably in a casual by-the-way form, and voila, your sales go up and everybody wants to buy your product. Think of hot, sexy Beyoncé, for example, drinking Pepsi at one of her concerts, or George Clooney, successful, powerful, handsome, offering you espresso, a cup of coffee. Would you be able to refuse? In fact, people are buying not the product. It's not the product itself. I'm sure you can get a great cup of coffee here in college and in the center shop without even thinking about George Clooney. What people are buying are the attributes and success of the person using the product. Interesting that these marketing techniques are used not just just by the marketing companies. In perfectly rational world of of capital markets, companies go public because they need access to capital. In the real world, however, IPOs, initial public offerings or new issues, often seem to be packaged and sold as marketing, as consumer goods. Investment banks who are hired by the owners of a company to underwrite a new offer often act as those celebrities in product endorsement. Sometimes these underwriters are hired to get the celebrities of financial markets to invest into the new issue, replace, for example, Beyoncé with Warren Buffett or George Clooney with Morgan Stanley. Maybe not so sexy, but statement is just as powerful. These expert investors are approached very early in the process, and they get incentives from underwriters in forms of share allocation or underpricing. And they get this to ensure that these celebrity investors subscribe to the new issues. Sometimes underwriters prevent communication among investors or limit it to make sure that the information gathered in the market is not so successful as it could be. What do they get from this? They get a way to signal to the market that this product is worth buying or this issue is worth investing in. Thus, they create an information cascade, a situation where the rest of the market participants, the subsequent market participants, don't follow their private valuation of a company, disregard it, and follow the celebrities investors. In other terms, they heard. And they heard because, of, as the worldly wisdom of under the name of John Maynard Keynes teaches us, it is better for reputation to fail conventionally than to succeed unconventionally. This information cascade can create very high short-term proceeds for issuers and the underwriting banks. What I'm investigating through my research is how these information cascades are used in IPO markets, more specifically the manipulation of investment decisions through inducing information cascade. And there is an obvious moral reality here. That's why the issue is very important. The behavioral biases of market participants can be harnessed for both good and for bad. If financial decisions can be easily manipulated through an information cascade, then there is an obvious great need for different policies on information disclosures, information dissemination, and information gathering. Maybe markets are better off without information disclosures altogether. Thank you very much for your attention. About George Clooney? No?
Could you tell us a little bit about your findings?
I'm in the second year of my research. I have done as far as my hypothesis. I'm only going into the data collection at the moment. I have a few observations. And one of the obvious things is that the communication is prevented by the underwriters. And this is sometimes IPOs, especially in are dispersed. The investor base is dispersed over the different regions and geographically very often. Because this prevents the communication among the investors, the information is not gathered as easily or as efficiently as it could be. And therefore, as I said, the celebrity investors that invest into the issue are very visible to everybody. And the private valuation of the companies become not so obvious. So people follow and they heard and they invest in the offers.
Great, thank you very much. Well done. Our third speaker is Anya Murphy, also from the School of Business.
The topic of my presentation is momentum in the UK largest stocks and is it still profitable? And supposedly to begin what my research question is, and it is obviously, is momentum still a phenomenon within the UK market between the years of 1995 and 2013? Now, to begin with, I must explain what momentum is. And basically, it's this idea that stocks that have performed either well or poorly in the previous time period will continue to perform in that direction in the coming months. So it's the idea by looking at past prices, we can predict what future prices may be. Now, obviously, anything that goes or follows this idea that the past price performance will predict future price performance goes against this idea of the efficient market hypothesis. And what the efficient market hypothesis basically states is that, you know, we're all very rational, we all do what we're meant to do, and there's no kind of way to make excess returns within the market. However, what momentum kind of says is, well, actually, there isn't that. There's this idea that we are quite behavioural people, we're not always 100% rational, and yes, there is these opportunities to make excess returns within the market. In fact, kind of one of the main people behind the efficient market hypothesis, I suppose, Eugene Fama, even he stated that maybe, you know, momentum cannot be explained rationally. There has to be a behavioural reason behind it. So, like I said, the main, I suppose, question I want to answer in this research is momentum still a feature in the UK market? Now, why should we care about this topic? Well, any time that you want to ascertain why your market is efficient, it's obviously important to do so. Also, if anyone in the room, I'm sure some of you lucky enough to have a pension fund, there might be a certain percentage of that which is actually managed by, be it a broker or it could be managed by yourselves. And these people actually trade based on anomalies such as this. So they may be trading based on momentum. In other words, they could be buying stocks for your portfolio based on its performance in those months. Also, what makes this paper is a bit different is obviously between the years 1995 and 2013, we're all well aware that there was unique market events. I hate to use the word, but there was that global financial crisis. And we want to see if momentum acted differently within these time periods. So, you know, did it have any effect on the market, either as a behaviour or did it have any effect on the market with regards to momentum? Now, I'm not going to put up complicated equations of how the research was conducted, but basically we just, hypothetically, I suppose that we bought stocks that had performed well in the past, you know, we held on to them for a while, and we've seen what their returns were in the future. Now, this is just some of the initial findings, and I suppose like all research is kind of still ongoing, so they are only initial findings. But you'll see from the graph on the right-hand side that it's actually momentum over the entire sample period of 1995 to 2013. And you can see that the lines actually mimic each other somewhat in behaviour. Even if you compare this just looking aesthetically at the lines, on the left-hand side, it's a snapshot of 2008 and 2013. This would be incorporating, obviously, the global financial crisis. And clearly, you can see that there is some difference and there is quite a marked contrast in how the lines interact with each other, suggesting that, yes, the global financial crisis did have some impact on momentum. Obviously, further analysis is required to establish the significance of the events and so forth, but this is just some initial preliminary findings which we'll be delving into further. So thank you very much.
Yes.
So
a lot of people would say that one of the biggest impacts on the stock market in recent years has been the introduction of algorithmic trading by computers.
Yes.
So what's your opinion on how that might have affected the momentum of shares?
To be honest, it mightn't be something that I've considered yet, but definitely something that I have to consider. I suppose I'm looking at this research from a behavioural aspect. So it would be taking out that computerised element. It would be looking at, you know, the cognitive psychology of investors, really delving into that and how they trade. So I think definitely I'll have to give some acknowledgement to the percentage of trading done by, you know, these algorithms and so forth that are kind of done. But obviously those algorithms are also built on something, so maybe it might be worthwhile looking into that. And it has been suggested to me before as well, and something I will consider is even talking to the brokers and the analysts, you know, seeing how they form their kind of opinions, because they're, I suppose, kind of the computer for a lot of us that might trade individually. So yes, I think that's something that I definitely will have to acknowledge in my research. Yeah.
Okay, moving swiftly along, our next presenter is Helen O'Keefe from the School of Business.
I guess I have to acknowledge, first of all, that anybody that knows me will know I'm a talker, so for me to put this into 3 minutes is going to be a huge achievement. Okay, collaborative innovation in new product development is widely accepted by both academics and by practitioners as being the most effective approach to success in the area. However, it's difficult, and there is little guidance on how to achieve this in either the academic literature or the business literature. The reason for this lack of guidance is because to date, within the academic literature, the construct of collaborative innovation intensity has not been fully operationalised, nor has it been fully explored in the practice literature. Consequently, there are numerous NPD projects, collaborative projects out there in the business-to-business realm that are underachieving. The aim of this research is twofold. Firstly, I want to address the academic literature gap through the development of a measurement instrument for the construct. The first step is the identification of the sub-processes within the collaborative innovation intensity process, which is today's presentation. And secondly, it's the provision of a roadmap for the practitioners, giving guidance on how to achieve successful collaborative NPD, which obviously is hugely important. Right, this research is steeped in the social exchange theory, with the process of collaborative innovation intensity being viewed as a series of interdependent interactions, with the intensity levels of the process being determined by these interactions. Following an overarching literature review, including teams, NPD, knowledge management, and business relationships, to name a few areas, in conjunction with an ongoing case study, the following processes or dimensions, sub-processes or dimensions, have been identified as being part of the construct. The construct has been defined as the breadth and the depth to which the two parties are involved in the collaboration determined by the interactive processes. Currently, six processes have been identified. You can see them there on the slide. Ongoing communication, information exchange, joint learning, joint problem solving, joint creativity, and ongoing social bondings. So these dimensions obviously form part of our conceptual framework for the research. This slide represents diagrammatically the six sub-processes of the process. In the future, this study will build on previous literature through the development of a sophisticated scale that measures collaborative innovation intensity. It will result in a cross-sectional view of the process and allow for the discrimination between different levels of the intensity. Using the measurement instrument, different levels of the intensity will be modelled against NPD outcomes using structural equation modelling. For us, that will be Lizrel. The development of this measure and the modelling of the impact of the discriminant intensities with regard to the outcomes will address the gap in the academic literature and the practice literature and provide, in particular, practitioners with a toolkit for successful collaborative innovation. In the overall sense, this research should promote more innovative behaviour in a business-to-business setting. Thank you.
Just I'm going to be mean now because I'm the chair, so I can do what I like up here, you see. So can I ask everybody just to stand up? Just so we'll ask the question standing up for this one. Great, thanks. So have we got a question? Great, just to stretch the legs. One question from anybody?
Sorry, yeah, I'm just wondering, have you identified of any of the parameters of the roadmap being more important than
Pardon
others?
Me?
Are any of the parameters that you identified for the roadmap more important than others?
We haven't actually got the findings in place to identify those as yet, to be honest with you. I mean, we're in the process of doing an ongoing case study where we're actually, you know, looking at collaborative innovation intensity as it happens. But at the moment, no, there isn't any one of those dimensions that we think is more important from the point of view of the roadmap. But hopefully towards, like at the end of the PhD, we'll have a much better idea.
Great, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well done. You can all sit again. You've all just interrupted your sitting, which is very good for your health. And we're moving on to next presentation is from the School of Health Sciences, and it's Mary Reedy.
Welcome to my presentation. Women with intellectual disabilities have poorer cancer awareness and lower participation in screening programs than women in the general population. Regrettably, this leads to later cancer diagnosis with poor outcomes for the women with ID, despite cancer rates being similar in both populations. The principal aim of this mixed method study is to test the feasibility and acceptability of a targeted intervention to promote cancer and screening awareness for women with intellectual disabilities. Embrace's ID, our early monitoring of breast and cervical cancer signs and screening in intellectual disabilities, is an intervention designed for women with mild to moderate ID and their carers. Embrace's ID aims to raise the women's awareness of cancer warning signs, risk factors, screening programs, and importantly, to promote early health seeking on discovery of a breast or cervical cancer screening cancer symptom. In phase one of this study, I wanted to explore the cancer and screening awareness of women with ID and their carers in the Southeast region. So having analysed the surveys of 125 carers and 45 women with ID, as well as 25 carer interviews, I had some answers. Gaps in awareness levels were noted for everybody, but in particular, women with ID, many of them couldn't even name a single risk factor for breast cancer. And their carers suggested that comprehension difficulties and communication difficulties may have impact on their awareness. Following the MRC guidelines for the development and evaluation of complex intervention, the Embrace's ID intervention was designed based on empirical evidence and a theoretical framework. 25 women with ID and 9 carers joined in the program. For the women with the ID, the 25 women, you can see most of them were aged under 50, had no state exams, and lived at home with family carers. In this figure, we can see the recognition of breast cancer signs were increased following the intervention. This is pre-test, post-test, and the 12-week intervention for 4 key areas, breast arm lump, breast rash, redness, and breast pucker. In this slide, we can see that the women were the drop from 76% to 60% on their ability to recall a breast cancer risk factor at follow-up. And the knowledge of the breast cancer program was also raised following the intervention. Finally, in the final slide, we can see that the women's ability to notice a change in breast change and early help seeking was improved. Thank you for listening to me, and if there's any questions.
Well done. One question?
Yeah, we're in process. These are preliminary. This is moving towards the final stages of the PhD. So the qualitative elements are being analysed in Invivo at the moment at baseline, in the same time frames as the qualitative, so that I'll be able to draw them together and identify from their survey responses and their interview responses where it didn't work for the women. Communication difficulties were different, especially in the narrative responses for the women who didn't engage as well as some of the other women. So, but those results will be presented in October with the final thesis.
Our next presenter is Bernard Butler from TSSG. Is that right, Bernard?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, thank you. Just start. Okay. Access control is something we don't really think about, but it's actually a very important thing when we join a corporate network. It's never been easier to share information, but it's also, with that great power comes great responsibility. And in particular, people are not always aware that when they join a network, they have to keep asking permission for to do things, because they're not actually trusted to do these things just because of who they are. So one of the things that an administrator of a network needs to do is to actually encode the business policies and basically define what they are and do it in such a way that when those policies are evaluated, it doesn't intrude on the normal usage of that network. Otherwise, people would be sitting around waiting for a decision to come back. Now, of course, this is a tricky problem because, first of all, you've got to model the domain that you're protecting, and it's not always clear how to do that. And in particular, if you make some changes, you can't always predict what the effects on performance might be. So what we did was we developed a test bed. It's made of three main components. Domain Manager, which is a modeling tool, which allows you to create the domain, configure it to a particular type of domain. So for example, if you're a small, a medium, or a large network. Stacks, which is basically a measuring system. So basically you run a system where access requests are issued to policy engines, and then the responses are given, and you time those responses, and you figure out how much they are, and you can basically get quite a lot of data from that. Those data, of course, have to be analyzed, and they go into a system called PowerPacks, which is an analytical and statistical tool, and basically allows us to take all that data and make some recommendations in terms of these are the problems you might encounter, and these are the sort of things interventions you might make to try and ensure that the access control system continues to perform as it should. Particularly, that's an issue when we're introducing ever more complex, compliance requirements. This is just a picture of, would you believe, some policy sets. I've using a graphical format here, which I developed. Each of those little dots is an entity, which is a part of a policy system. On the one on the left, they represent a small domain, so relatively simple. Now remember, the domain is actually captured not just in the dots, but also in all the lines which join them. On the right-hand side, as you see it, is a much larger domain. And what we found when we did some measurements is that the timings are quite different depending on the size of the policy sets you're working with. And interestingly enough, sometimes increasing the policy set size can have a detrimental effect, but it can also depend on other things. Sometimes it's easier to find out the answer in a large set because you find the answer quicker because it's just the first set policy you look at. So we've got some nice results, and I'd like to open the floor to any questions. Thank you.
Any questions?
I was just interested in terms of when you're building these systems, your prioritization of activities. Is that one of the reasons for modeling of this, so that based on, say, traffic, or say, for example, in terms of communications, that you can make decisions based on use? Is that so it's prioritization, so you can improve the speed of data transfer?
It's not specifically the data transfer, it's more about the decision whether you can actually get to the data.
Yeah.
So sometimes you could actually build in a measure of the actual performance of the system in terms of just data flows, but it's not actually a consideration in the policies we're looking at. That's a different type of policy. We're just looking at the access control policies. But you're right. The overall time depends on, obviously, the decision. So you say, I ask a question. Yes, I can do it. Then start the data transfer. Obviously, as seen by the user who is not aware of the asking for permission, they only just see, oh, the system is slow.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's it.
Great. Thanks.
Thank you. Cheers.
Thank you very much.
Our second last presenter today is Andrew Harrington from the School of Science and Computing.
Sorry.
My presentation is titled Non-Invasive Genetic Tests for Identification of Bat Species of Ireland and Great Britain. Okay, so in Ireland we have 9 species of bats, and in Great Britain there are 17 species, and they roost in caves, trees and buildings such as churches, houses and so on. Bat roosts are quite prone to disturbance by human activity, and for that reason bats and all the roosts are protected by law. And for example, if a house needs to be renovated but there is a bat roost present in that building, bat survey needs to be done to actually mitigate against possible disturbance to the bat roost. And therefore we need to know, you need to get a survey by a bat worker, an experienced bat worker, and you want to find out what bat species are present. We can collect bat droppings without disturbing the bats present in a roost, and we can use those as a source of DNA, which we can use for DNA testing to find out what bat species are present. So what we use is quantitative PCR, or qPCR, which is a method of DNA testing. And what it boils down to is that the test actually binds to a section of DNA that's unique to that particular species that you're interested in. So there's one test for each species. And what happens when you're testing your sample is that you'll only get a positive result if there is DNA from that particular species you're interested in present in your sample. So what we see on this graph is that when you have a positive result, you'll get this line, the line rising above this, what we call a cycle threshold, and when you get a negative result, the line bounces along the bottom of the graph and doesn't rise above the threshold. So it's a simple yes-no answer. qPCR has advantages over other methods of testing, so it's massively reduced time and cost. You can pick up DNA from several different species within one sample, and you can pick up DNA in very, very low quantities. Okay, so it's got great advantages over other methods of DNA testing. So what I did was I designed these DNA tests for the 17 species present in Ireland and Great Britain. I actually validated them with samples of known species. And then once I'd done that, I went out and carried out a field study in County Waterford. So I visited 65 different bat roosts. I collected droppings from all of those, and I used my qPCR tests to find out what bat species were present. So I was able to identify the bat species present in 87% of the roosts I visited. And so you can see on the chart there the species that I discovered. And I actually also found that 20% of these bat roosts are actually occupied with multiple species, which probably wouldn't have been possible to do before. So basically what I've done is I've created these tests and I've shown that they work, and they're also that they can be applied to a field study. And this should be a very useful test for bat surveyors in the future. Thanks very much. I did, yeah, actually. So a lot of the sites I visited were actually in churches. So obviously the two main denominations of churches in County Waterford would be Catholic, and there's obviously Church of Ireland churches. So I found out that brown long-eared bats are Protestant and that Pippa's churches are Catholic bats. Bit of a simplification, but there you go.
Best answer of the day. Our last presenter in this section is Kira Powell from the School of Science and Computing.
Hi, thanks for the introduction. So my research is investigating non-invasive genetics to apply to wild deer populations in Ireland. Deer populations in Ireland are expanding in both range and abundance throughout the country. These expanding populations have the potential to severely impact commercial forestry and local biodiversity. Traditional monitoring techniques are prone to error, particularly in the misidentification of pellets when conducting population estimates based on pellet encounter rates. To address these issues, I've designed non-invasive genetic methods to monitor deer populations. To do this, I designed qPCR assays for the identification of species and sex of red deer, sika deer, and fallow deer from their pellet samples. For individual identification, I designed a microsatellite panel to obtain a genetic fingerprint from fecal pellets that the deer leave behind. genetic fingerprinting of fecal pellets allows you to capture an individual without ever encountering it. Every time you come across the same genetic fingerprint in the same or subsequent sampling sessions counts as a recapture. This allows you to use CaptureMark recapture software to obtain a population estimate. I took my methods and applied them to the case study site in North County Cork in the Boggara and Nagel Mountains. During a preliminary survey in December 2012 and May 2013, 38 volunteers surveyed the entire area and collected 707 pellet samples. Of those samples, 145 were identified as deer, with the majority of the remaining samples identified as sheep or goat. This really highlights the importance of using molecular methods to confirm species, particularly when basing basing population estimates on fecal encounter rates. This survey identified the Nagel's study area as a very suitable site to conduct a non-invasive genetic population survey, which I then conducted in December 2013. So during a two-week period, I surveyed 110 kilometres throughout the Nagel study site and collected a total of 389 pellet samples. Of those pellet samples, 327 were identified as fallow deer. I successfully genotyped 172 of those samples and identified 74 unique individuals. Using the CaptureMark recapture software CapWire, I was able to obtain a population estimate of 115 individual fallow deer within the Nagel study area. In conclusion, I think I have demonstrated that the species assays have worked well and are particularly useful for distinguishing between deer and non-deer species. The CaptureMark recapture study worked very successfully and may present a more reliable method of population estimate for deer as opposed to the traditional monitoring methods. Thank you very much, and I'll now take any questions. I suppose the size, the larger area, I'm just going to, the general method is you want to collect three times as many pellets as you think are in the population. So if you have a closed population, as I would hope I would have in the Nagel's Mountain, that's quite isolated and doesn't have surrounding forestry that might link it to other populations. If I can cover that area and in this case I had 327 samples and ended up with a population estimate of 115. It suggests that I did get enough coverage of the area that is to produce a realistic estimate of what would be in the area. But then again, like, the larger the area you're looking at, the more contiguous the habitat, the larger survey effort you're going to need. Thank you very much.
Just to let you know, our final presenter couldn't be with us today. This is the final presenter on your programme. I'd just like to finish by inviting the judges to go out and to deliberate over the next 20 minutes on their, if they want to go now, they could do that. And I just want to say thank you very much to everybody who undertook this really, really difficult exercise. I think it's a really fantastic way to get a snapshot of some of the fantastic work that's going on in the Institute. So just one last final round of applause for all our presenters.
Okay, and we're still waiting for white smoke from our oral judging panel. I'm not sure, I think there's a bit of a fight going on at the moment. But if you want to join us outside for some refreshments, we have Sean Walsh outside who has his classical guitar. He's doing a master's in the Department of Creating and Performing Arts. His supervisor is Hazel Farrell, so he's outside, and if you want to have a chat.